Okay, so one of the points I want to start out making is, as Americans, we're all eating way too much sugar. The average American is eating about 140 pounds of sugar annually. That equates to about 57 gallons of soda. 100 years ago or so, we ate about 10 pounds, so it's gone up enormously. This is mostly in the form of sucrose, table sugar, glucose, and fructose. And fructose is particularly bad because sugar is not sugar, as you've heard the corn companies say. It's simply not the case. Fructose is metabolized quite a bit differently than glucose. And in fact, high fructose corn syrup is now, it's very cheap compared to sucrose, for example, but it's ubiquitous. It's in virtually every processed food you look. And I encourage you, when you go to the grocery store, usually the first or second ingredient in things like ketchup and almost anything. In fact, this weekend I was trying to find chocolate milk for my granddaughter, and I had trouble finding chocolate milk where the second ingredient wasn't high fructose corn syrup. And I think this is really bad because fructose, unlike glucose and table sugar, sucrose, has both glucose and fructose in it. And so glucose is actually stimulates insulin signaling and is regulated. However, when you eat large quantities of fructose, almost all of it goes to the liver and is metabolized as fat, and it doesn't turn on insulin signaling to regulate. And it also, eating a lot of sugar makes you hungry. It actually inhibits the signals in your brain that tell you to stop eating. And so if you think about diabetes, and I'm struck by the fact, and this is my own family's this way, if people are diagnosed with cancer or heart disease or something else, they really get upset and they take it seriously. A lot of people, when they get diabetes, don't think it's any big deal. It's a very big deal. The number of people that die from diabetes every year is on the order of 70,000 directly and 250,000 indirectly a year in the United States. And why is that? Well, when you have hyperglycemia or high blood sugar for prolonged times, what happens is you develop particularly the symptoms shown on this slide. So, for example, your kidney quits working properly, so you have nephropathy. It's a major cause of blindness. You get retinopathies. A lot of people that have diabetes, so something like 74% of them, have neuropathies of the feet in particular. It's a major cause of amputations. Cardiovascular disease, a lot of it is in fact indirectly caused by diabetes. The beta cells, when they're prolonged to exposed to high glucose for a long amount of time, lose the ability to even make insulin, and that contributes to the later stages of the disease. And of course, your liver and skeletal muscle and adipose become resistant to insulin the more it's exposed to high glucose. So why is prolonged blood sugar so toxic? If you think about this as a chemist, these sugars are not toxic molecules at all. They're not chemically reactive all that much. So why are they so toxic? So it turned this. I'm not so a big fan of this thing. So it turns out that several years ago, my laboratory discovered a modification of proteins that involves the direct attachment of sugars to practically every regulatory protein in the cell, in the nucleus and the cytoplasm. What this sugar is a molecule of glucose that has a nitrogen and a so-called an N-acetyl group attached to it. It's an enzymatic modification, and it's very much analogous to what you've heard about in signaling, about phosphorylation. It acts like a switch that turns proteins on and off, much the same way phosphorylation does, but it's a sugar. It's an extremely abundant modification. So far, about 4,000 proteins have been identified, but you can get a feel for it in that gel up there in the corner is a 2D gel, just giving you an idea of how many proteins are in the nucleus or cytoplasm of most cells that have this sugar attached to them. It's most abundant, as it turns out, in the pancreas, the brain, and lowest in the liver, but it turns out the liver has the highest dynamic range of this modification. And this sugar cycles on and off proteins during their lifetime, and it turns out it's a nutrient sensor. It's the way your cells in your body regulate what their proteins do in response to nutrients. And it's a perfect nutrient sensor because the donor of this sugar is a molecule called UDP-GLUCNAC, or UDP-N-acetylglucosamine. And the biosynthesis of this molecule is directly tied to glucose, amino acid, fatty acid, and nucleotide metabolism. So the metabolic pathways in your cell raise and lower the levels of UDP GlucNAC, which in turn help determine the amount of this sugar that's attached to your proteins. And it turns out that the site on the molecules where this sugar is attached, in many cases, are the same sites that are often phosphorylated in signaling transduction pathways. And so signaling, you can think of as microcircuitry that controls the protein's functions in metabolism, much the same way switches do. And it turns out the O-GlucNAC sugar is like a rheostat that modifies the signaling in response to nutrients. And because it has this complex relationship with phosphorylation, it's involved in virtually everything the cell does, including gene expression by transcription, nutrient sensing. It's involved in numerous diseases. So this is an example of how sensitive, if you take a cell, this happened to be a lymphocyte, and you expose it to increased levels of glucose, you can see from the top panel, that's normal glucose. And if you expose it to diabetic levels of glucose, the number of proteins and the amount of proteins that have this sugar attached to them goes up dramatically. And so we now, and others now think that this is one of the major molecular mechanism of why so much goes wrong when you have prolonged hyperglycemia or too much glucose surrounding cells. And so how might this work? Well, it turns out that, as I said, signaling molecules, the switches that regulate metabolism, are regulated by this nutrient sensor, this sugar attachment to proteins. And so there's a balance between phosphorylation and the addition of this sugar that gets out of whack when sugar stays up too high. It turns out that virtually every protein that's involved in regulating the expression of genes is modified by this sugar. And we're just beginning to learn how this sugar plays a role in whether genes get activated or not activated. And also, it turns out that mitochondria, we've known for a long time that in diabetes, when glucose gets high, the mitochondria quit working right. We never have understood the relationship. How does high glucose cause a mitochondria to not work right? And when the mitochondria doesn't work right, it makes these reactive oxygen species that do further damage to the cell. So what I want to do now is just go through one example or so of each one of these kinds of processes and how they're important to the toxicity of glucose. So one of the things that happens in both adipocyte and muscle is we know about the insulin signaling pathway. So insulin binds to its receptor, and then through a complex cascade of signaling, it causes GLUT4 vesicles to go to the surface and bring in glucose, and this helps lower the glucose in the bloodstream. It's very important in skeletal muscle and adipocyte. Well, it turns out that when the sugar levels get high, O-GlucNAC, this sugar I'm talking about, goes up and it actually stops insulin signaling at all the steps that are shown there with the star. So it's a molecular mechanism of what we call insulin resistance. The second thing is we now know that virtually half and maybe more of the kinases that regulate these signaling cascades are themselves modified by this sugar. And I have a list of ones that have recently shown how they're regulated by it. And an interesting example of this from a collaboration we did with Don Behrs at UC Davis talks about CAM kinase 2, calcium calmodulin kinase 2. This is the kinase that regulates your heartbeat. It's very important in regulating calcium flux in your heart. And it turns out in diabetes, it gets this GlucNAC sugar, which normally is not there, attached to it at the position shown here in the molecule, and it causes this enzyme to become constitutively active. And so, therefore, it contributes greatly to arrhythmias in the heart with individuals that have diabetes. Another example from work in our lab by a postdoc named Shirkette Peterson, we were looking at the expression. So she's really interested in diabetic nephropathy, or the kidney function. And there's two proteins in the kidney called nephrin and podocin. In this cartoon, they're the filtration apparatus that make the kidney filter out large molecules and let the rest of the urine pass through. What happens when O-GlucNAC is high, as it is in diabetes, You can see the levels in this labeled TMG, which is an inhibitor of the enzyme that removes the sugar. The addition of this sugar gets very high. It turns out that when the addition of this sugar is high on the proteins that regulate gene expression called transcription factors, as you can see in this bar graph, the black and the gray bar going down on both nephrin and podocin, these genes are no longer transcribed, and basically the filtration apparatus of the kidney begins to fall apart because the proteins that make it are not being made properly. And you can reverse this even in high glucose. If you add an inhibitor of the enzyme that adds this sugar to proteins, you can see in the checkered bar that the transcription of these proteins is restored. Now, coming back to the mitochondria, so why does the mitochondria quit working when glucose is high? It didn't really make a whole lot of sense biochemically. Well, it turns out there's about 88 proteins in the mitochondria in the electron transport chain. This is the portion of the cell that makes ATP from glucose and other molecules, makes energy that drives your cells. And 88 proteins involved in that have this sugar attached to them. And it turns out in normal mitochondria, when the levels of this sugar goes up, it actually makes the mitochondria work better to make more, so as it would if nutrients are around. But if you look at diabetes, it turns out that the enzyme that adds this sugar, by mechanisms we don't yet understand, becomes mislocalized. Normally, it's located in a protein complex called complex 4 in the complexes that make ATP. But in diabetic animals, a lot of it moves to complex 3. And as a consequence of that, a whole different set of proteins become modified with this sugar that normally would not be modified to this extent in the mitochondria. And this actually results in the mitochondria not working properly. So there now is a direct link between having hyperglycemia or high glucose and the misfunction of the mitochondria. And the last thing I want to talk about is appetite control. So we've already heard that there's a region in your brain called the paraventricular nucleus in the hypothalamus that where leptin signals and other things and is involved in appetite control. And together with Rick Hugener's lab in neurosciences at Johns Hopkins, a graduate student, Olaf Lagerhoff, decided to knock out the enzyme that adds this sugar in adult mice in that region of the brain and ask what happens. Well, it turns out within 2 to 3 weeks, you get a morbidly obese mouse. This mouse cannot stop eating. And it's a little bit like the leptin mouse you heard about, except in this case, what this is telling us is not only is this sugar a nutrient sensor in every cell in your body, but it's also a nutrient sensor in your brain. It tells your brain how much glucose is there, and it's one of the mechanisms involved in controlling appetite. And so what I've told you about is a sugar modification that's really quite ubiquitous in biology. All plants and animals, it's actually required for life, even at the single cell level in mammals and plants. It has this crosstalk with other molecules and signaling like phosphorylation. It's very important in gene regulation, and we know very little bit how it works in regulating whether genes get transcribed or not in response to nutrients. But the bottom line of what I'm telling you here is that this is a mechanism that probably underlies why having too much sugar in your bloodstream and surrounding your cells causes all of the range of problems that exist and contributes to the disease we call diabetes. And the future for this, if we have a drug that could lower the extent of this glucanacylation globally, you'd have to not lower it too much or it would be bad. But the real drug targets in the future, it turns out this enzyme is regulated by specific targeting proteins. And if you could make small molecules that stopped it from being targeted to specific substrates, then you could have a useful drug for diabetes. And so I just wanted to thank the people in the lab and collaborators that helped us do this work, and thank you.